Welcome, everyone. Clarity Ross here. Callie Ross is probably off somewhere taking video. He's been really taking a lot of video, a lot of athletic action and doing stuff. And then Juan Carlos is he's everywhere, and I'm right here clarifying to my very best extent. And I've had a day of a spontaneously amazing clarity. This is what I do. And it's just everything 360 degree clarity, that's all. And I know people like would say, well, how do you get that? What, you know, what road do I go? It's 360 degreeness rather than some sort of linear technique in any particular direction. It's just this overall 360 degreeness, which is quite difficult. It's taken quite some doing to nurture this along. But this is what we need, actually. Just realization is 360 degree realization. It's not partial, it's total. What we are is total freedom, not partial freedom. We're 360 degree freedom. So this is valuable, to have 360 degree overall familiarity, comfort zone. This is difficult. We tend to specialize, people here tend to specialize. I never specialize in anything. I always went for this overall 360 degreeness. A lot of work. And it's been recognized, this is the quality that the Dharma kinks look for. They're looking for those who are willing to do this and are working on it, have done it to a large extent. They have perfect 360 degreeness. They abide. They have abidance. Abidance is 360 degreeness. We are abidance, actually. It's not that we are abiding. We are abidance itself. So they said, hey, we'd like you to help us out. And I said, well, you know, I'm not a specialist at anything. You know, so that's okay. You know, that we like that. The 360 degreeness is what is crucial. I said, okay. He said, well, I'll stumble along best I can. So Longchenpa suggests, can you take on the role of what we call a Dharma prince? Like a king has a you know, vast area that they have dominion over, that 360 degree dominion over this big area. And within this area, there's principalities. And the princes have some local jurisdiction over these principalities, and they have loyalty to the king. And this is how the king administers these large areas, is having loyal princes. Okay, this is how it's done throughout history. And so the Dharma kings they want and need, and it's helpful for them to have these Dharma princes that help them in their work. Just like a king needs these princes to help the king keep, you know, stability and thriving culture and everything that needs to happen in the kingdom. So Longchenpa said, the Nyingma masters, starting with Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang Kyatse, Choki Lodro, they asked me, would you like to take on that responsibility? I said, well, I don't know. Some people aren't going to like that, especially those who think that the age of the gurus is finished. No more gurus, they say. I mean, what could be stupider than to say that? Because gurus are the ones that encourage and mentor us towards success in getting what we really want and experiencing what we really want. That's what a guru is. They know what we really want and how to get what we really want. And they mentor us and help us and encourage us in every way. So how could anyone possibly say that they celebrate the end of the age of gurus, that we're finished with gurus? That is just the stupidest thing ever. It's a very juvenile attitude. It's like, yeah, we got rid of our parents, you know. Except these are like super parents, totally benevolent. You see, this world, what is this world? This world is actually, we made this world as a device to distract us from success in being what we are, and to foment failure to accept what we are. So people come here to fail. About 99.99% of the world, their focus is on failure. Failure to get what they really want, which is to just experience themselves as God created them as, formless spirit and in perfect freedom. And this world supports failure. This is what its purpose is, to support failure. So obviously it's a world full of failures. It is. Very much so. Not many here really want to succeed. The game of failure is played in different ways. Some just directly say, yeah, I'm totally into failure. I want to be a perfect failure. And then the others will say, no, they pay lip service to spirituality, but it's superficial and it's only done as lip service to try to kind of, you know, say, well, I've done enough and that's enough of that. And let me, so I can keep on with my failure. It's just two different styles, same coin. So to say, hey, we don't need any gurus in this world. That's the inmates taking over the asylum. And they say, don't worry, we'll pay homage to the old gurus and we'll say the nice things that they said, but we don't want any more gurus in here now. We've got it from here. Okay, that is so ridiculous, so absurd. We don't have it from here. The world is so deluded. And what is delusion but the dance of continuity fear? It's the dance of continuity fear. That's all that it is. And it binds us to this world. This place that is custom designed to keep inducing failure. You see, success keeps rising within us naturally because we still are what we are. And it's like the fire of success in being what we are is always arising, and we're desperate to put it out. You know, put it out. How do I put out that fire? And the world says, "Don't worry, we'll put out that fire for you." So we come to this world like our mother, you know, shielding behind our mother. Oh, mother, please protect me from the fire of my success. You know, this is how it is here. Actually, it's exactly what goes on here. And yet the success, the fires keep reigniting. And we say, oh, I need to come back. I need to, you know, pay more. Let me go back to the world. I'm getting too close to success. As if success were some horrible thing. And success is just what? Abidance. Spirit of abidance. So the gurus, what do they help us with? Spirit of abidance. They move us towards spirit of abidance. This is what they do. They help us in every way. And our continuity fear is so terrible that even the best of us are sabotaging our success all the time. Everyone in this world are professional saboteurs. Otherwise, I wouldn't even be here. The only way you can be here, other than out of complete compassion as a guru, is to sabotage your success in recognizing what you really are. That's the only way you can come here. Identify with this nonsense. So we're all professional saboteurs, and repentance means to accept, recognize this fact. We have continuity fear. We've been sabotaging our success. And this continuity fear is a very severe problem. And so as long as I have it, I'm going to keep sabotaging my success, and I'm going to keep identifying with time, space, process, and form, with failure. Failure to accept what I am. And that will continue on life after life after life after life. I'll go on and on and on and on. And there's no such thing as a perfect failure, really. It's not like we permanently don't get what we really want, and then say, okay, we're happy because that's permanent. You know, stable not having what I want. But there's no such thing as stable not having what I want, because the desire to have what we really want always keeps arising. So it's not stable. It's impossible to stabilize delusion, self sabotage. It's impossible. And yet the world keeps saying, no, it's possible. It's a liar. The world's a liar. Plain and simple. We fashion this world to be a liar. That's all that it is. But because it's just a mental projection, we can have truth enter into it and pay no attention to the lying aspect of it and see just beauty for beauty's sake of it. That's enough. To be reminded of that light has not been changed and corrupted in any way is enough for us. So the gurus, they know their business. Their business is to lead us into the spirit of abidance. What does spirit of abidance mean? Spirit of abidance means, like, let's say you just love music. Well, you have the spirit of music. Okay. In other words, your spirit loves music. The spirit of music. I've had that for a long time. But I have a more powerful spirit of abidance now. Okay, it's way better. Spirit of music was just trying to make myself happy with failure. But now I see I can actually have success. I say, wow. I still listen to music. I don't listen to much music. Actually, I sing rather than play it or any. I'd rather be directly involved rather than just passively listening to it. I don't like to just passively listen to music anymore. If there's some music, I'm singing and I'm making it better, and I feel like, you know, total involvement in it. And it's pretty cool. You don't have to have all the you don't have to be part of a band or all the instruments. You can just sing. I still have the spirit of music. It's not like it disappears from you when you find something better. The spirit of abidance is what we're really after, because that's what we are. In other words, spirit of abidance means love of truth, love of abidance. This is what you really want, and you just love it. You just like, if someone loves music, you know, they're just always listening to music and playing music and talking about music, and you can tell they just love it. They'd rather listen to music than anything else. They just, oh, put that song on. I want to hear that. I just love it. This is the spirit of music. So just imagine that towards abidance. I just love abidance. This is all I'm interested in. I just, this comes before everything else. That's called the spirit of abidance. This is the aim. This is the aim of the gurus for our lives, okay? This is what they bring to us, and they know their business. Now, I'm associated with the Nyingma masters, starting with Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro, because they're the ones that made me an offer. You know, they said, we want you to work for us. And I didn't even know who they were. Never heard of them. But, you know, I said, well, I'll consider it. You know, I mean, thank you so much for offering. That means a lot to me. No one else has offered me for me to work with them, and, you know, because probably I'm a better fit with the Nyingma masters. So, but, you know, to just be asked is pretty amazing. It's like a college saying, we really want you to come to our college. You know, we think you'd be a great fit here. If it's a really great college, you'd say, wow, they're really looking for great students and recruiting them. And that means a lot, right? If like some really top-notch college contacts you and maybe even sends a recruit out to you and says, look, this is what we can offer you. We really want the very best students because that makes our institution better. And we feel that you're one of those and you'll be a good fit for us. And we'd really like to have you as you know, and be an alumni of us eventually and be part of our family. That really means a lot. Now in athletics, they do that. They recruit. The coach goes and meets the family, the recruit, and they talk and tell them how great it's going to be that your, you know, athlete has been going to our college. And they recruit, actively recruit. And that means a lot to the recruits that they're wanted. So I was recruited by the Nyingma masters. They say, you have what we're looking for, what we are looking for. And I didn't even know who they were. I said, what? I'm just, you know, muddling along here. They said, yeah, but you're muddling along with the goal of 360-degree spirit of abidanceness. That takes some muddling. So that's okay. You'll get there. I mean, just you recruit someone for college. They may muddle along their first year or something, but it's down the road. The stick to it, and that's to say, someday you'll get a degree, and then you'll come back for a master's degree and a PhD or whatever. And so you're going to be part of this institution because we know you're really into it. You have the spirit of academia or something, and they want to perpetuate, you know, their institution by having top academia there. So it's the same similar to Nyingma masters. They want to perpetuate their success by having top recruits who will really work to perpetuate the success and bringing everyone to the spirit of abidance. So they saw that in me and they recruited me. And I said, wow, that's great to be wanted, isn't it? It's great to be wanted. Man, you know, I of course you have inferiority complex when you're talking to Longchimp. It's just like, but you know, you say, okay, I mean, that's okay. It's not really a complex. It's just you realize you're a little fish, but that's okay. You know, you'd be swimming in a big pond, and that's good. Room to grow, room to grow, a lot of room to grow in the right way. So, being a Dharma prince in the Nyingma lineage is no easy feat at all. You have to be recruited by them. Now, I never expected that. That was never my aim, really. It's just, I hope that someone was paying attention, but I didn't know. I just like if you're in high school, you hope maybe some college is paying attention, and I don't know, or if you're an athlete, certainly you hope they're scouting you. Right? So I didn't know. It's just a surprise for me. It's just like, oh, really? Someone's been scouting me, and someone knows. I'm sure, like, you know, Jesus and like Ananda, my mom may have told the Nyingma masters, hey, I think he'd be a really great fit for you or something. Or maybe they probably knew themselves too. I don't know how it works. But they, you know, they're always aware of what's the right fit for you. And certainly Nanda Maimon didn't want me to fixate on her. Her thing is to put you into the right place to maximize your success. She has no spiritual ego at all. She doesn't care if you're a devotee or not. It's how successful are you going to be, and where can you be? You know, it's a true spiritual mother. Where can I put you so you're going to be spiritually successful? It has nothing to do with her at all, as far as her ego or anything. No spiritual ego at all. So she even maybe said something that kind of irritated me, and maybe say, yeah, I gotta find a better fit, you know. Probably did that on purpose. She would do something like that. She said something that could be construed as saying, well, you know, women are going to take over the world, but that, you know, that'll be helpful for everybody. And she kind of made sort of this blanket statement, maybe to please somebody, whatever reason she said it, and that men have to take the oars, you know, do the heavy work now. And I said, well, wait a minute, whoa, wait a minute. She just said it to one person. She had reasons for saying stuff to each person. But when I heard that, I kind of said, ah, I don't quite like that. But I realized today I was meant to hear that just to drive me away from her, so I would find a better fit, my best fit. So she doesn't really have this lineage and all that stuff. Her thing is support of all these lineages. She helps mother us and mature us spiritually so that we can fit in to the right place. Pretty amazing, huh? Ananda Maima is supremely helpful, the queen of all Dakinis. You can't even imagine how helpful she is, actually. But at any rate, I got mature enough to, through hanging out with her for so long, to be able to feel, oh, Longchenpa, oh, okay. I wasn't, you know, intimidated, or, you know, I sort of so used to the pressure of hanging out with the queen of all Dakinis, the supreme guru of all gurus. That I could handle it. Okay, these Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Jemmyn, Genchi Chöki Lodro, and it's not overwhelming for me. I just I'm kind of I'm used to being a little, you know, realizing that I don't know anything compared to them, and that's okay. I'm used to being the big fish, and I realize they're not going to crush me. It's like a big elephant, and I'm a little baby. I'm a little ant, you know. But I say, ah, oh, no, they got their eye out for me. I'm okay. They're not. So I'm not scared of the gurus, because I've been treated so well by Sri Sri Ananda Maima, Ram Maharshi, Jesus Christ. I've been treated so well by them that they're nothing but helpful. They've been nothing but helpful for me. Perfectly helpful, and they've just been immaculate. So, why should I be scared of the gurus? You know, there's no reason to be, really. Not the Dharma kings. So to function as a Dharma prince, what does Dharma mean? It really means 360 degree involvement in going towards spiritual abidance. It really means everything that's involved in moving us into the spirit of abidance, moving us into the spirit of abidance, the whole 360 degreeness of it. That's the Dharma. So it's just all everything that's involved in moving us there, is getting us there. So a Dharma prince is one that you have to have 360 degreeness to you. You have to be very flexible, agile. Nothing is, you say, yeah, I'm aware of that. Yeah, I'm used to that. I'm this and that and this and that and that. It's just an overall rounded out smoothness of in every direction. I just feel comfortable. That's a Dharma prince who's getting really comfortable with 360 degreeness. The Dharma kings have perfect comfort and familiarity with it. They are that. They are that. They are the abidance. See, for me, I'm getting used to abidance, but ultimately, the realization is I am the abidance. I am abidance. I am abidance. That's what I am. So we have this. I guess someone said, I'm watching the debate. I said, debate? What debate? Somebody debating? What are they debating? Are they debating the Dharma? I don't think so. There's really nothing to debate. So we're not here to debate. So I represent the Dharma. And I work for the Dharma King Longchenpa, who's part of the great Dharma King lineage of the Nyingma masters, starting with the inspiration of Manjushri, who really inspired Buddhism to start with, and Padmasambhava, who inspired Tibetan Buddhism, and then Longchenpa, about 600 years later, from Longchenpa, who perfected Tibetan Buddhism, you might say. And then 600 years later, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, who was the embodiment of this perfection of Tibetan Buddhism. Okay, that's the Nyingma masters, so to speak. The Dzogchen Nyingma masters of Tibetan Buddhism. Now, they're ultra professionals. They are super committed to the Bodhisattva task of bringing all of us into a spirit of abidance. And they've been super committed for a long time. They have this vast, wonderful culture of extreme commitment. But it makes me look like I'm just not committed at all. Their commitment is so astonishing. And so they know their business, which is to bring us into the spirit of abidance. And so they know, they're aware of the winds that are blowing in the world as far as leading us astray from that. Of course, you're in business, you know the marketplace, right? So they know the marketplace of ideas and trends and ideas and what's distracting us. Where is our attention? It's all a play of attention. The spiritual dharma, the dharma is a play of attention. Dharma means the 360 degreeness. I don't like the term the path. I've never been comfortable with the path. It applies this linear approach that you're going along this path. It's not, it's more 360. You're getting comfortable with 360 degreeness, which is really abidance, which is what we are. But it's not really a path. So you don't arrive at 360 degreeness. How could you arrive at it? You just get comfortable with it. I am that. Already here, already that. We just have to stop trying to be something else, right? When we stop trying to be something else, we realize, oh, I am already am what I am, right? I didn't arrive there. I just stopped trying to leave there. I just realized trying to leave is futile. I can't leave. And we recognize the futility of that. Then we just, oh, okay, give it up. And then there you go. There's a spirit of abidance is there. So they know the marketplace and what's going on in the world better than as as well as anyone could possibly know. I mean, they're so committed to their business of helping us out that of course they would be super keenly aware of the marketplace of the play our play of attention. What is tugging at our attention? What is distracting us away? What are the trends that are leading us astray? And what can we do to remedy this? That's their business. That's what they do. So they're perfectly aware of what's going on. And they certainly have a plan devised to help us out. Can you imagine an expert business person with expert knowledge of the marketplace, of the trends, and great awareness of how it's all going, that they don't have any market strategy? No business strategy? I mean, what kind of business person is that? That's absurd. They'd be out of business in a big hurry. And the Nigma Masters have been in business for a long time. So they certainly have a business plan. They certainly understand the marketplace and what to do. Meaning they know how to help us. Our play of attention to keep it from being distracted. How cool is that? It's very cool. Now, I had an experience, or I might say, Cali Ross had an experience. It was in the Cali Ross mode there yesterday that was just really extraordinary. It's the kind of experience you hope that you have. You hope in your life you have experience like that, and I had it. And it was just a extraordinary sign from the Nigma Masters that they have our backs. And they are going to show up at the right time with the right remedy for us. This is what they do. This is their business. The great businesses know when to show up with the right product at the right time. They assess the market, the trends, and what product people want, and it's and boom, it's right there. This is what they showed me. And they showed me in an extraordinarily dramatic way. And if I explained it, nobody would believe it, actually. I have some of it on tape, but even then, nobody would believe it. You have to experience it to believe it. It was just so almost unbelievable to me, and yet it happened. But some of you might believe it. So I'll explain it to you a little bit. I'm at the coastline trying to tape birds in flight. I said, I need this for some videos. But they weren't showing up. And I started really concentrating on the birds and saying, birds. And praying. I did this mantra. I was praying this mantra, various mantras, beautiful mantras. Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Spirit of Abidance, Lang Chenpa. And then different mantras. Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Spirit of Abidance, Lang Chenpa. I was chanting that one too. Anyway, I was trying to get these videotape on the coast, on coastline. These birds are flying. The sun was setting. I wanted the birds, take a video of the birds flying across the sun or in the beautiful. I wasn't having very much success at all. And then suddenly I started getting intuition. I flipped into this inspired mode. And suddenly I went off trail. And I suddenly raced up to this promontory right on a cliff. And I looked around and suddenly there's this huge flock of birds in a V formation. Just beautiful. Just flying in front of me across the sky. I was like, oh my gosh, this was what I was looking for. And I start taping. But I tape with the GoPro and I find that fisheye lens makes anything that's at a distance look like it's 1,000 miles away. I should have used my other camera. I just I don't know what I was thinking, but I was thinking slow mo, but I can get slow mo on my other camera too, at least two times slow mo. Oh well, live and learn, but that's not important. What's important is I began, as I kept repeating this mantra and this affirmation, the birds kept showing up. And I started asking the birds, do this, do this, do this. And it's like right after I started asking for it, the birds would show up and do what I was asking them. I said, I need you to fly overhead. I said, please, birds, can you fly overhead? I really need. Boom, they'd show up and they'd hover overhead. I was like, okay, let me take this shot. And I was just like stunned by it. Somehow, I kept thanking the grace of God. I said, thank you, God. This is amazing. I'm getting all these perfect shots. They didn't turn out so perfect. They used a GoPro, which is not good for distance shots. It's much better for close-up action stuff, is what it's designed for. Put it on your snowboard, your bicycle, or something, and you're taking close-up stuff. It's not good for distant landscapes at all. It turns the setting sun into a little pinpoint. But anyway, the birds started showing up beautifully in every which way I wanted them to. I was just saying, this is amazing. Something's really, the grace is with me. I'm at the right spot at the right time. Suddenly, everything's working out the right way. So I was just in this great spirit of thankfulness. And so the sun was setting. I was doing time-lapse photography of the setting sun. And then I thought, you know what? To cap off this beautiful day, what I really want is some birds to fly across the setting sun. And I want to capture that. And I talked to this man that's there, and he's there at every sunset, he says. And he watches the sunset. And I asked him, why are you there? Why you go every day? He says, to watch the green flash. And I say, what's that? He says, you heard of that? I said, no, not really. Maybe once I've heard something of it, but he said, oh, it's true. He says, when the sun's setting, it gets just low enough, when the optics are right, you get these green flashes coming off of the sun. And he's looking at it through binoculars, actually. He said, when it gets real low, he uses sunglasses, and then polarized sunglasses, then binoculars. And he looks at the setting sun, and he says he sees if it, when the optics are right, these beautiful green flashes coming off the sun. And the binoculars even accent the colors and everything. He says it's just spectacular. He just loves it. But he says everything has to be, at the right moment, it happens. And we were talking about birds. I said, I saw some birds flying. I said, maybe they're geese or something. He goes, well, they might be geese because they're in formation, a V formation. But other birds fly to V formation. But he says, probably pelicans. I said, pelicans, huh? I said, wow, I love pelicans. I love how they fly. And I said, I'd love to see some pelicans fly across the sun. I'd really love that. That's what I'm hoping for. And he says, who knows? And so then I started this mantra. I said, Manjushri, Manjushri, Pabasambhava. Spirit of abidance, Longchenpa, Manjushri, Padmasambhava. Spirit of abidance, Longchenpa, Manjushri, Padmasambhava. Spirit of abidance, Longchenpa. I was just, in my mind, I was just invoking this powerful affirmation of faith in the gurus. And so I'm standing there, just watching the sunset. Camera's just taping this, and suddenly off to my left, these birds suddenly appear, and they're flying slow and low and close. And I look at them and I said, oh my God, it's pelicans. Now, I hadn't seen pelicans all day. There were different birds. There was a lot of crows and different things. I hadn't seen any pelicans, and these pelicans were in real. Pelicans tend to fly pretty close to the shore, actually. At least that's my experience. They were flying very close to where the camera was. And I said, this is amazing. This is just what I asked for. And I look at the sun, I said, oh my God, it's at the perfect moment where the sun is just about halfway down. I said, I said, yeah, but they won't keep coming, or they'll fly too high off camera. They won't go right across the sun. They'll be up high or something. I said, please, pelicans, fly right across the sun and close to, you know. And they kept coming, and they kept coming. I said, oh my gosh, they're going to do it. They're going to do it. And these four pelicans in a line just beautifully flew right across the center of the camera, right across the center of the sun. They were centered right by the sun. You could not have arranged it better if it was completely scripted and done this way. It was just an awesome sight to behold. And I was speechless. I was just speechless because exactly what I had asked for, at exactly the right moment, in exactly the right way, everything was scripted, choreographed perfectly for what I was praying for. Yeah, I was just stunned by it. And it was four pelicans. I said, but I was only praying to three, Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa. So today I woke up and I suddenly realized, ah, oh, there are four pelicans. Yeah, it's Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Spirit of Avoidance, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Lodro. Wow. Four of them. I left out Jamyang because I couldn't figure out how to put it in the by practicing, you know, smoothly, but I figured it out today. You say Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Spirit of Abidance, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Lodro. It's like a Zen, it's a perfect 5-line Zen poem, right? Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Spirit of Abidance, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Lodro. I think a lot of the Zen poems like 5 lines, right? And you know they say da 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 da, and the last line just like, you know, zips it up just right or somehow. This is perfect. So we have like this perfect mantra, this perfect affirmation: Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Spirit of Abidance, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Lodro. Wow! Remember to always wow your success. The key to success is wowing your success instead of analyzing it. Don't analyze. Nip that in the bud. So just keep wowing your life. Wow. So I just wowed the pelicans. I said, wow. I didn't analyze it. What did they do? Who? Just wow. Just wow. It was stunning. Now I got it on GoPro, and it looks like they're a million miles away. Of course, I didn't think to take it my other camera, but I'm having to learn this. So I zoomed in on it. It's not as, you know, as clear as it could have been. It was spectacular because actually they were very close. You could see it very clearly. It was just extraordinarily beautiful, and it's like something, you know, one in a lifetime thing where you hope for the shot and you put yourself there and you just worked for it and you say, I just, you know, it had to happen just at that moment and in the perfect way, and it all just unfolded that way. If you're a videographer or photographer, you have to have a lot of faith, and you know, really, because a lot of this stuff is you just have to pray for it. And the birds really cooperated. They very much cooperated. It was just something that was truly amazing to experience. And I realized, hey, everything is a dance of attention, including the birds. Their attention's dancing too, just like ours is, okay? And their attention can dance to the gurus just as well. The 360 degreeness, absolutely they can. And the gurus could say, I'd like you to fly across right here across the sun and help us out. Someone wants to, you know, to put you on tape and wants to experience that. And so here they come, very purposefully. Birds have consciousness, I'll tell you that. I mean, absolutely they do. Animals, of course animals, everything does actually. A dance of attention. You call consciousness just a dance of attention. And, you know, real consciousness is 360 degreeness, just all the time. It's not a dance of attention. It's just, it's stillness, silence. I realize today's silence is 360 degreeness. saying everything. Wow. So, the gist of all this is that the man telling me how it just, if it, when all the circumstances are just right, to get this extraordinary phenomenon happen. And right after he told me that, the pelicans fly by after invoking the Nyingma masters to help me out. I prayed to them to help me out. I've had astonishing success with the Nyingma masters. It's so astonishing. I'm afraid to even ask them, because they're going to respond. I'm like, wow, this is just like, really? We're not used to that, are we? So what it means to me is that the Nyingma masters are going know what's going on in the world. They know when to make their move, their chess move, okay? They know when to make it. So we don't need to worry. They will do what they need to do to help us. And they know perfectly well what to do to help us. So we don't need to worry about what it is. Just have faith. Trust it. I trust the grace of God will have exactly what we need for us. So it's nothing to worry about, actually. Nothing to try to analyze or fret over. It's just prepare to be helped and to wow at the help you're getting. Just wow it. I'm getting super help. Wow. Stay in the 360-degreeness. Wow is how we stay 360 degree. It's a very rounded sort of thing. I think of wow as like, you know, it's just wow, this ball of wow, with all these potential reactions are there, right? All these potential reactions, and yet we're just feeling the whole ball, just one ball, and any and all reactions could be there, except we just choose to see it as just one overall reaction of wow. So this really helps us move towards 360 degreeness, which is what we really need. Okay. So the ability to wow your success, the practice of wow, is all important. Because there's a lot of success we have coming to us. A lot, so much, it's just we don't want to think how much there is. There's so much, right? So we have to be very expert at wowing our success. Otherwise, it won't come to us. Continuity fear will block it. We'll be too scared. So much success is available to us. Spiritual success, of 360 degree success. That's a lot of success. So we have to just wow it when it just keep wowing every success. So I wowed the pelicans. I just wowed it. Had a lot of success taping. Some not so successful. I'm still the GoPro. I mean, but that's fine. You have to experience it for yourself. I can't give you the experience. You have to actually petition the gurus for grace of God. If you want to call it the Holy Spirit, that's fine. Whatever you want to call it, the grace of God, petition and receive, practice. PRP, petition, receive, and practice. Make sure to wow it, the success that you experience. And this is how you grow in faith, is your own experiencing. I've had so much experience in my life of successful responses to my prayers. It just, the evidence mounts and mounts and mounts and mounts, and it just becomes incontrovertible, you know. It's so extraordinary. People say you're so lucky. You're always in the right place at the right time. What is it? Nobody's that lucky. Okay, it's ridiculous to call that luck. How absurd, right? This is all that those who want to fail can do. They have to deny the source of success. The grace of God is the source of success, so they believe in luck. They keep saying luck. I've never been lucky. I've only been blessed. And they're promoting luck, 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 gambling, 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 luck, 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 luck. And This brings you into small potatoes. You know, it's a way. It's failure. It's how to fail. I'm always in the right place at the right time, because the grace of God alerts my attention of where I need, what I need to, I need to, you know, move here, go here, do, you know, like that. I always feel like I'm being kind of helped. People get my attention, or to help me out. So I just feel whatever anyone says is to help me out. I missed one. Someone help me out. This lady, this woman said, "Do you don't have? Do you happen to have a white dog? Because there's dogs wandering all over." I said, "No, I don't." I said, "What does she mean by that white dog?" Oh, and I just realized now what she meant. I didn't get the all the pictures that I wanted. No, well. I don't always do, you know, flawless. I try to the best I can, and you know, I realize I could have done better. But it takes a lot just to do a really good job, actually. I'm scrambling all over the place, chasing birds, the wind blasting sand in my face. Kind of trying to, your attention is so much focused on trying to find the birds, you're not really paying much attention of where you're walking or where you're going. I mean, you have to really have this 360 degree kind of confidence in I'm in such good shape. I feel like I'm not going to stumble or fall. I can catch myself. My balance is good, and so this helps me kind of have multitask, do really good at multitasking in a quick way. Doing a lot of various quick shifts and changes. I was running. I did some running. I had to go fast, and I was running really great, but I feel it today. Oh man, I tell you. So it's a good sore when you feel real sore, but you, 'cause you really been active. It's like an active soreness from activity. And it's good. It's good. I feel that probably you probably should feel that way every day, that you really pushed yourself activity wise every day. You feel it, but you don't want to overdo it, because it's, you know, too much, and you need to make sure the body doesn't start going into this inflammation reaction. Then you feel like really terrible, like you're like, ah, oh, I'm so old and decrepit and gonna die. I feel so terrible. And then it goes away and you feel good again. But most people take Advil. I don't take any medicine, so I have to watch that. Be careful about it. So it boils down to what? To your practice towards spirit of abidance. How do you get to spirit of abidance? Well, it's kind of like, how do you swim across the channel? Well, you swim. Right? And someone asks, "Well, how do I swim across there?" Well, you swim. Wow, really? You gotta swim? Well, yeah. If you want to know how to swim across, you swim. Swim across. That's how you do it. So we said, "Well, I can't swim." Well, you better practice swimming. You start your practice, and you do, you know, short laps, and then more and more and more and more and more, and your distance gets better and better and better. And that's how you do it. You want to swim across the channel? You got to be a really, you know, good distance swimmer. But it's just a matter of practicing. You'll be able to do it, or if that's what you love to do. So, going toward the spirit of abidance is what practice. If that's what you love to do, then you'll do it. You will practice, because you realize if you want to be a really great musician, guess what? You'll be practicing a lot. Now I know what that's like, and you know, it was nothing for me to practice 8 hours a day. I love doing it. Come home from school, get home like 3 o'clock or so, and I'd be playing till midnight. neglected my studies. I never really studied. Didn't need to. I was able to just, get good grades just by real quick. I was just able to do it up to a certain point, but then I lost all interest. I said, I'm not interested in, what they're teaching me. So if you love the goal, then you're going to practice. If you're just practicing for practice's sake, you're going to get bored and you're going to quit. But if you say, this is the vehicle to get where I want to go, I'm just on a trip, I'm driving, and I'm going to where I want to go, but I've still got to steer the car and use the accelerator and the brake, right? Yeah. So practicing is like that. It's like driving a vehicle. You got to pay attention and drive the vehicle, and you got to be a good driver. But the reason why you're doing that, is because you're somewhere you're driving to, basically. To use that as an analogy. Yeah, I want to go down south, and enjoy the desert or something. Well, okay, let's drive down there. I enjoy the drive down there because I know why I'm going down there. I'm fired up. In fact, I'm just saying that I'm fired up. I was on the edge of this golf course, and it seemed like somebody was coming over towards me, and I just left. I wasn't on the course, but I was right on the edge of it. And it's like I got chased away. I was like, hey, stay off our course. You don't belong here. I could have just stayed there, and I said, look, you should invite me to play. Don't chew me out. Invite me to play. You're on your course. If I had some nerve, I would have done that. Maybe someday I will, but I didn't want to bother him. It's a really super private course, some beautiful super private course. I said, why don't you invite me to play your course? It'd be a blessing for your course. You're not blessing me with the course so much. I blessed you to play your course. Come on. But no one sees it that way, right? No, you're just, you don't deserve our golf course. I said, hey, it's the other way around. Who's in charge of this world? The world's in charge of us. Are we in charge of the world? And who can recognize that? That's valuable. Man, I could have said, look, yeah, it's a nice course, but I'll crush the course. I'll crush any golf course. That's what I was thinking in my mind, saying to him, I'll crush any golf course. I'll just crush it. Believe me. So I must be feeling pretty confident to think that way, right? That's what I was thinking. Bring it on. You think you got some nice course? I don't care. I'll crush it if I'm feeling it. So I must be feeling pretty confident to say something like that, because I haven't been a golf course crusher in my life at all, but I feel like I am now. I don't know why. I just feel it. Like, wow, bring it on. Because of the new swing that Longchampa gave me, I feel very confident, even though I've not been out on a golf course. I never used it on a golf course. Only just hit a bucket of balls, so that's it. But I feel very confident. I know, because it gets my arms fully extended, and I can just, this massive centrifugal whip type of, I know I can just crush the ball. I can just crush it. And so, you got a golf course, bring it on, I'll crush it. I'll just be driving, long driving all day, and just stuffing it and knocking in the putts, and so don't try to intimidate me with your golf course. I was feeling that way. It was pretty funny. It's like a burly Scotsman was coming towards me. It's like with the walrus mustache and very officious, like get away from my golf course. I said, dude, I had to, I said, dude, this is Callie Ross, man. I mean, come on, what do you mean? You want me off your golf course? You should want me on your golf course. It would be like an honor for your membership to even have me play your course. What are you talking about? You're chasing me away? I mean, they wouldn't chase Jordan Spieth away, would they? Say, Jordan, get off our course. You don't belong here today. Well, maybe they would. Some of these private courses, they'll chase anyone away. They chase Jack Nicklaus away. Maybe not Arnold Palmer, but Arnie's gone. I don't know. But, hey, don't chase me away, Invite me to play. That should be a mantra. Don't chase me away. Invite me to play. It's an honor for you to be even be on your course. Come on. How many of you really have a 360 degree, you know, Dharma presence? Probably none of you. Probably none of you. You know, so people, they don't understand what the value is. They think that, you know, specialization, I'm a specialist, I'm a surgeon, that's nothing. Try being a 360 degreeist, and then you'll find out, you know, what real discipline is all about, what real study is all about. 24/7, you know, nonstop. That's rare and it's valuable. So don't chase me away, invite me to play. What are you thinking? Oh, could you play? Play? I'll crush your course. I'll crush any course. There's no course I can't crush if I'm feeling it. Now, of course, you don't. Nobody says that, you know, except Tiger Woods. So maybe the spirit of Tiger Woods is getting into me, which is good. I mean, could you imagine saying a Tiger is a difficult course? No. There was no such thing as a difficult course for Tiger Woods. It was awesome to see him just go crush these courses. All these membership, you know, these burly Scotsmen says, you know, we're setting up our course, you know, for you, and we're going to set up so tough, you know, it's just going to just bring you to your knees. It's going to crush you. Our course is going to crush you. We've got the greens rolling so fast, you know, with bunkers deep and roughs really high, and, you know, no, that's going to destroy you, pros. Tiger Woods shows up. Yeah, he's heard it a million times before. He says, guys, okay, I don't want to hear it. I'm gonna bring this course to its knees. I'm gonna crush it. Watch. And he proceeds just to absolutely obliterate the course. Yeah, he might score low or he might not score low, but either way he obliterates the course. Right? I mean, sometimes the putts fall, sometimes they don't. Sometimes the chips go in, sometimes they don't. You don't always shoot a low score. That's not always the mark of obliterating a course. It's how you play it, and they have everything set up so, like, you can't do this, you can't do this, and he just says, I'll go right over those trees. I'll go right through the bunker. I'll go right, you know, nothing's stopping me. I'll hit every shot I need to hit, and I'll make the putt, and I'll do everything, and the course members are like humiliated, like, how could he do that to our course? You know, the Masters went crazy after he obliterated the Masters. Well, how old was he, 19 or 20 or 21 or something? I mean, he just obliterated, like 19 under or something, completely obliterated the record at the Masters, and they were just beside themselves, you know, humiliated, the membership. So they start planting a bunch of trees, changing the tees longer. They tiger-proofed the course. They tried to prevent anyone from ever doing that again. And then Jordan Spieth finally matched that 19 under a couple of years ago. Pretty amazing. So he obliterated the course. So these great golfers, I mean, you could make the course as tough as you want. They're going to just, you know, bring the course to its knees somehow. Yeah, it's just amazing. So the people don't like that here. They don't like success. They want failure. They want to see you fail. We want to fail just like we fail. This course makes us fail every time. You're going to fail too. So I love to see those who don't fail, who succeed. Right? Don't some of us love that? Yeah, of course we do. Of course, most here want to fail. That's why they're here. They feel failure is familiar, comfortable, and they look at success as they're, you know, an abyss, an annihilation. They'll go crazy if they have success or something. So that they're terrified of success, terrified of getting what we want, which is the spirit of abundance. That's what we really want, because that's what we really are. So they're so terrified. They're obsessed with failure, actually. So it's great to just be able to say that, yeah, right? Just to have this attitude, feisty enough attitude. I'll absolutely crush your course. Any course, not just yours. Bring any course on you want. Doesn't matter. That's the spirit of Tiger Woods there. Not afraid. He wasn't afraid of any course. Wasn't afraid of any of them. Didn't matter how they set up, you didn't care. You'd even set up any way you want to. Let's go. You try to do this? Okay, I'll hit a 2 iron 270 yards, nice and low under the trees, you know. I'll just shape it perfectly. I'll do whatever I need to do. I'll hit any shot. Whatever you do, I got countermeasures. Now that's stupendous, watching that. Knowing that they're out for you and trying to stop you and they can't stop you. Like that. So we want success. We want success. All right? And the world wants to sabotage our success. That's what it does. Like I said, you can't come to this world unless you're a professional saboteur. And they're very good at sabotaging our success. They try their very best at it. They don't want Jesus hanging around here. They say, "Jesus, you're too successful. Get out of here. You know, that you're ruining our gig." Okay. So what golf course am I going to crush? This is what I'm thinking, you know. Maybe, you know, that's a metaphor. Like, what? I was just crushing it today, clarity-wise, just crushing everything I look at, I'm just able to just crush it. Like, what I mean is, that's a golf term of hitting your drive 320 right down the middle. You know, absolutely, and just that, and you've got then what, 80 yards? 80 yards, nice little pitching wedge right into the pin on a 400-yard hole. You're crushing a 320. You're flying over all the bunkers, the fairway bunkers. You're just flying over them. You don't even pay attention to it. I'm going over those. That's just crushing it. And so you're just, you know, the yardage is not an issue for you. And you're just hitting, you know, great shots every hole, and just you're just overpowering the course with your capacity. And it doesn't really present, you know, it's not bothersome for you at all. You say, "Oh, that was easy. That's a lot of fun." You say, "Ah, easy, a lot of fun." Or is it, "I want a real challenge." So you do that clarity-wise, as far as I'm just, everything I see, I'm able to just, it doesn't present a problem for me. All the troubles in the world, all the stuff that's going on, it's, done with it. Nothing there to see, really. So that's good. That's what you're looking for. You're looking more and more for this 360-degree capacity. And it's possible. You just have to keep wowing your success. This is how you do it. You don't analyze your success. You don't put it into words, because then it gets unstable. Words are so flimsy and unstable. And they're really nothing at all. Just arbitrary labels, right? So you're making it, building a house out of straw. Don't do that. Refuse to label and analyze and structure. Refuse to structure your success. Refuse. No, my success is 360 degrees in every which way. There's no structure to it. 360 is my structure to it. And wow. Wow. And just keep wowing your success. Then you will find your success will, more and more and more and more and more profound success will come to you. And just keep wowing it. So what are the Enigma masters? I don't know what they're going to do. You know what they're going to do. Clearly, their attention is on the issue of our play of attention, as it always is. Clearly, they know that something bad is going to happen to our play of attention. They're very aware of that. I don't know exactly what, but they know. Everybody's kind of aware of it. Everyone I talk to drops hints one way or another about what they feel is our play of attention is really going to get sabotaged very severely. The stuff that people say is quite amazing. Someone told me, he said, "Solar, you realize that it's going to be mandated by 2026 or something? There's all these mandates coming. These people, there's lots of mandates coming down the road. We don't understand this. The United Nations has massive amounts of mandates coming coming over the next 15 years. These mandates are filtering down now. It's the sustainable, what is it, development project, or what is it, the United Nations, I forgot, but the 17 sustainable goals or whatever, they have these goals, and they have a master blueprint for the whole planet, and this is being filtered down now through all the governments, down to the all the local, you know, the federal, down to the state and local, and there's just this massive avalanche of mandates coming towards us. This is true. People are telling me this stuff in the business. They say, oh, I know what the mandates are. I said, really? And they said, oh yeah, everybody has to do this. So the future in this world is all these mandates. And of course, politics is coming from the think tanks, really coming from the ETs, through think tanks, then to the United Nations, then to the, you know, the world governments. That's how it works in this world right now. This is the control system here of the planet. It really starts from extraterrestrials, goes through the elite think tanks, then it goes into the United Nations, then it goes into political parties and leaders of the political parties and their followers, and then it filters into the media, filters into entertainment and media and all that, then it is into the local governments, and then to you, down to you. All these mandates are a massive flow of mandates are coming to us. We're going to be hit by an avalanche. So they have their candidates that they want to win. Why? Because they'll play along with this. That's why. And of course they say, well, it is necessary to save the planet. There's a lot of ways to save the planet. But the way to save the planet is to save ourselves from the planet. Save ourselves, to truly save ourselves from this planet, which again, we made this planet as a device to subvert our success, to sabotage our success. And we can give a different purpose to it. That's how to save the planet. So if you know this, you realize that the future is a rather ghastly future, unless you're really into being regulated and mandated to death. And it's interesting that the ones getting blamed for ruining the world, were they the ones who mandated the Green Revolution and mandated everything that's caused this massive population, gone from like 2 billion or 1.5 to 7 billion people? Were they the ones who did that? No. It was really the United Nations and you know, the Green Revolution and a lot of the stuff that they pushed through is to cause this massive population. Plus, the healthcare is keeps everybody alive to 90, you know. They're the ones that are ruining the world. Or, quote-unquote, ruining it. They say, no, this planet can sustain 50 billion, you know. We just have to make sure everyone's completely regulated. Well, why should we do that? What about the quality of life? Why do you just want quantity? So we're obsessed with greed. Everyone, it's a greedy place, and people lose sight of the quality of culture. It's amazing how this gets pointed out to me. Oh yeah, they're good. You know, they do this, they're good, and you know, work hard, make me money. They help me make money and money. It's how much money you make is. We don't look at culture. Culture helps us with our depth of mind, our faith in the deep mind, instead of the superficial failure. Failure is very superficial. So when we're into failure, we think the mind is very superficial, and then we hope that that's all there is to the mind. We try to cut ourselves off from the rest of the mind. This is what's happening in the world. Let's just say that the superficial, that's all there is to the mind. And if we all agree upon that, maybe that'll be true. You know, this like make-believe, crazy stuff. This is the guiding principle of the world, is let's just say that we're shallow, okay? And that's all there is to the mind. And we think we'll escape the abyss by doing that. And of course, what we are still keeps arising. The fire of remembrance keeps arising within us, and then we get afraid, and we get all these mental illnesses and defenses and stuff. This is how it works here. ETs have their own reasons for this planet. They like the biodiversity. They want to genetic engineering. They want to do all sorts of stuff that they want to do. And so they fomented this excuse, you know. They said, "How can we infiltrate this planet?" Mary said, "Okay, let's create a crisis on the planet so that they need our help." They said, "Okay, how do we do that?" "Well, let's increase the population until it becomes a crisis here." Okay, so they filtered through this information on how to do that. The Green Revolution took place. Massive farming and fertilizer and insecticides and everything, so we could increase the population. And then the ET said, "Oh, guess what? You guys have a terrible problem, population crisis. You're destroying the ecosystem, blah, 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 blah." "Yeah, well, you're the ones who fomented the crisis." So then we would say, "Oh, ETs, please save us. You know, we do this all." And they say, "You know what? Your world's dying, but we're here to help you if you want us to." "Oh, yes, thank you." And so we invite them in, and they begin to sabotage the world and turn it in the direction of what they want it for. You know, pretty simple stuff, actually, right? That's their stock in trade. Create a crisis and then claim you're the one, you're the white knight comes along to solve the crisis. But you're the one that fomented the crisis in the first place, so people would turn to you and have faith that, you know, that you could solve the problem. And then they give you leeway to you know, that you want. That's the stock and trade of the ETs. That's what's happening here. And again, they're very clever at distancing themselves from it all. They know who to work through and the various avenues. They cultivate those so they can, and you know, that's what they do. Eisenhower found out about the secret world government, Area 51, you know, and he said, you know, he found out, he said, "Wow, I mean, you guys are just completely doing whatever you want to do. You're not following the laws or rules of this nation, or I don't govern, I'm not the pre, you're, you know, you don't even view me as having authority as the President of the United States." "But you're operating on the sovereign soil, but you think that, you know, the world belongs to you." This is way back in the you know, late 50s. And he warned the military industrial complex, military and industrial, I mean, corporate complex, the overall massive corporate complex has its own governance, its own rules, its own agendas. Beyond, it doesn't pay, you know, any attention to sovereign nations or anything like that. They believe they run the planet, and sovereign nations just exist for their pleasure, for their convenience. This is the way the world is, and how about the mandates that are coming, you know, so that they get things the way they want it to be. But if not for the population explosion, this would have never happened. And, you know, so pretty interesting, huh? I wouldn't have done that. I would have said, "Look, we don't need all these people here, actually. Why?" It just makes things, the quality of life goes downhill, culture goes downhill. They want culture to go downhill. They want just corporate culture to rule the planet, which is superficial culture. And when you're superficial, you feel cut off from your being, you're easy to manipulate. You're easy prey for their greed. And they want to know everything about you because they're like gamblers. They want to know how to win. They want you to be predictable in what you're going to do. Like gamblers in sports, they study the athletes, their tendencies, and they count on them to be predictable. But like for me, I'm unpredictable in that way. Like if I was a baseball pitcher, I don't even know what I'd do. If I was pitching a great game and someone came up like a struggling rookie, and I'd struck him out 3 times already, I'd say, "You know what? I feel like serving up a home run to this rookie. I'll throw him a cookie. Let him hit a home run. Doesn't matter." And sometimes I might just see the ball fly by. Like a slugger comes up, I say, "I want to see how far this guy can hit the ball. I enjoy watching the ball fly as much as anybody. So I'll just groove one for him." Gamblers hate this. The gamblers want you to be predictable. So really, the culture of the world is a gambling mindset, speculation, We don't realize how much of our world is controlled by speculators. They want us to be predictable, and they want to know our tendencies so they can know what we're going to do and make a huge profit off of it. But if you're like someone with like me, I'm 360 degrees spontaneous. I might not feel like pitching, but I say, you know what, today I just don't, you know, I feel like giving up a bunch of runs because I'm in the mood to do that. So I'll do that. And then someday I figure, today I just feel great. You know what? I'm just going to, you know, just strike everybody out and do that. But next day, I may not feel that way. It's whatever the flow of spirit tells me to do, I'm going to do that. That's what gamblers hate. They don't want you to be in the flow of the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, because they don't understand what you're going to do. They can't predict it. They want you to be predictable. So you could say that this planet is going in a direction where you are going, it's going to be mandated that you're predictable. In a very prosaic, shallow, predictable way, like a sheep, you know, they know what you're going to do. So they can just keep, you know, shearing the sheep. Just keep shearing the sheep. That's not what you were created for. So the attitude of greed is behind it, insecurity. Not getting what you really want, which is spirit of abidance. In other words, failing and trying to be happy with your failure leads to greed. Non-repentance leads to greed. Greed leads to speculation. Speculation leads to attempt to condition everyone into predictable robotic behavior. This is how it works. This is the psychology of the whole situation. Pretty amazing, huh? Wow it. Just wow it. Very nice evening. Oh, gorgeous day today. I mean, Lord. A jewel of a day. You just can't order up a better day weather-wise here. It was so clear and warm and sparkly and serene and blue and gorgeous. I just said, oh my God, look at those beautiful leaves, and the lakes are shimmering. It's just sublime weather, and it's evening, and it's like 8, almost 8 or 7:30, and it's just so nice and balmy outside. You just have to pinch yourself. Is it really this nice? Can I really? And you keep thinking it's gonna disappear. It's gonna lose. Here. In the world, nothing seems to stay the same, right? But that's not getting what we really want. So, there you go. We have a lot of clarity in many directions now, 360 degree of just how it works here. Non-repentance, you know, leads to the greed, leads to the desire to make massive amounts of money, which leads to speculation, and leads to trying to condition people so massive amounts of money can be made through speculation, so we're all predictable and we all follow the path that they want us to follow, so they know exactly, you know, how to make the money there. But I don't fit in that at all. You never know. I have no idea what I'm going to do. Moment by moment. What I'm going to say, what I'm going to do, I have no idea. Really, I don't. I just try to stay in the now. As an athlete, maybe that's why I didn't become an athlete, because athletes are put under there's tremendous pressure to condition athletes to be predictable, actually, by gamblers. In our society, in our culture, education, in every which way, it's a massive conditioning effort. And speculators are very clever people. And they're very clever at conditioning others to go act in the way that their speculation wants them to act in. So they know that you're going to zig here and you're going to zag there, and they can count on that. Unfortunately, a lot of genius in the world is mounted towards speculation. Because if you gamble, you're going to psychologically try and control people and get them to do what you want them to do. This is very true. It's easy to see that. As soon as you have some sort of wage or something, you start psychologically trying to analyze other people's minds and how can you get them to think in a certain way so that it favors you. But if you're not speculating in any way at all, You don't feel this way. You don't have to get into anyone's mind. I don't feel like I have to get into anyone's head or mind at all. I know that you either repent and then you go towards success, the spirit of abidance, or you don't repent and you go towards the spirit of non-abidance. That's it. And if you repent, then you will experience success start to come to you, and you just wow your success. That's it. I don't need to know what your behavior is going to be or what you're going to do or anything. The Dharma is the Dharma. You either do it or you don't. Very simple. So it's a beautiful thing not just to stay out of everybody's head and mind. Don't try to assess what anyone's thinking or going to say or do or anything. I remember the days where you know, I felt like I needed to do that. And it's terrible. It's terrible. It drives you nuts. What are people going to do next? It doesn't matter. You know, they either get with it or they don't. And if they get with it, success will arise for them. Certainly it will. And the more success arises, the more faith they will have in success. The more success will arise. And they keep wowing it. And just, you know, that you're going to go more and more to letting go of trying to leave what you are. It's very simple. Now, the Tibetans have some sort of such an amazing understanding. I don't know how they mapped it all out, but they certainly have. So they're experts in the play of attention, down to the most subtle. I guess, you know, it's just they're so committed to this that they just really map it all out. Play of attention. And so they know what's going on in the world, what's trying to interfere with our attention. Man, there's a lot that's trying to interfere with our attention. A lot of it is to say you're not worthy of it. You're not really worthy of that. And that just rests upon whoever they fear might have success. Again, what does the world fear? Success. The successful, those are truly successful, in which is the spirit of abidance is the definition of success here. And they fear that. And so they try to denigrate any of that. Anyone who goes in that direction, you know, as much as possible, denigrate, tear down anything remotely leading to that. So we stay in failure, and which is comfortable for us, at least familiarity-wise. So I've been aware of non-stop denigration of myself my whole life. Every principle I have, everything I hold to be sacred, important, 60 years of just hearing the world denigrate it and try to tear it down. That's it. And it generalizes out in like ripples out into broad generalities, which is what's happened in the world. Denigration of men in general is extraordinary. In fact, it's gone so far as to be just unbelievably alarming, because throughout history, men have been the ones who've had the most success in spirit of abidance, getting to the spirit of abidance. And in this world right now, it's so dedicated to failure that the very thought of success is so abhorrent to most people here that they generalize this abhorrence to men in general. Okay, especially like my age, where when you might succeed. So like an elder white male or elder males are viewed as a great threat, because, you know, what if some of them actually succeeds? You know, we don't want that here. What failure. So there's just been an unbelievable amount of denigration, demeaning, demonizing, demeaning, denigrating, marginalizing males, especially elder males, as a bunch of idiots, you know, who they're responsible for everything bad in the world. I mean, just nonstop denigration. That's all I've experienced in my life. is simply, you know, the male being denigrated for 60 years. That's all I've not ex- when I was younger in the 50s and early 60s, there was still some talking about men being competent, but it was eroding really rapidly. And from then it's just been nonstop free fall towards basically men have a lower value than dogs actually in the world. So it's kind of hard to feel that you deserve success when you think you're so terrible, which is what they're trying to do. They say you don't deserve success. That's part of the problem. Now they say no, you deserve failure because you're an awful person. You're terrible, and because we say you are, and therefore you deserve failure. So you can't succeed, which is what they're hoping. They're hoping you don't succeed actually. And so this will be you know, it's already institutionalized. It's the sport of the world. Is to go after men and you know denigrate their confidence in their, you know, capacity for 360 degreeness. No, you can't do that. So this all is going in such a direction that it's horrendous. The trends in the world are truly horrendous. We're being sort of shepherded into this corral, into a pen, and then penned in. ETs are very good at that. And so since I cherish success, I'm aware of those attempts to distract my attention away from it. So I'm very aware of it. And it's truly a catastrophic crisis right now. And the politics of the United States are very much involved with that, between the old guard and then the ETs, really. Those at the ET, they're loyal to the extraterrestrials. And the progressive liberals are loyal to extraterrestrials. This is a fact. They may not know this consciously. Deep down, they know it. But deep mind, they know it. And they feel extraterrestrials are necessary to save the planet from destruction. And so the ETs say, well, we have to have control of the planet and not the men. And that we can't have the men standing up to us, is what they're saying. If you want us here, you have to break male authority. And if you look at successful people in the world, in small success, but people who really can handle their business well, they come from families with a strong father. Okay? If you take a strong father out of the family, if you look at those who fail in life, so many of them come from single parent households, actually. Whether it's a mother or father, most of them come from mothers, no father in the house, especially prevalent African American community. It's an astonishing percentage of children don't have a father. Astonishingly high. I don't know exactly what it is, but maybe it's up in the 70% or something. Or it's just crazy. You cannot raise good children in a single parent household. It's a rare exception if you can. And these women think that they don't need a man. I could raise children perfectly well. I mean, they're crazy. The evidence is so against that it's just, you know, how could they possibly even think such a thing? But well, of course they're way overconfident in their capabilities. Way overconfident. You see someone who's just outstanding, like an African American community, many outstanding African Americans, most of them came from having both parents in the house, and like African American men, the ones who are really outstanding, their fathers, they credit by, I had a great father, you know, he was so helpful to me. And you need a great father. You need men to be super confident, and you need double authority. You need both authorities to raise children in this world. I was just thinking of that today. I was thinking how important it is where the kids put so much pressure on the parents. If it's one parent, they gang up on the parent, and after a while, the parent's just overwhelmed, and they just can't handle anymore. But if there's two parents, one can say, "Well, I didn't say you couldn't do this, but your dad did. So if you want to do this, you better go talk to your dad." And the kid goes, "Oh my gosh, I'm used to, you know, tricking mom. Can mom? I know how to push her buttons, but dad, he's. I don't know what he's gonna do, you know." And they get nervous. And they say, "Well, maybe I don't want it so much." So a kid will go, "Mom, I want the PlayStation. You know, I really need it because all my friends have it. I really want to do it." She goes, "Well," she goes, "Well, yeah, I understand." She plays a nice cop. "Yeah, I understand. Yeah, it'd be great, but you better go ask your father, dad, because he has the final say on this one." So she puts the pressure on the dad, but the dad says, "Yeah, you want it? Well, okay, you work for it." "Oh, no, I don't want it that much." And the kid says, "Ah, wow, I didn't get away with that one." So so that's how it works. You have to have the two parents in the household to be able to really manage your children in a great way. And even the ones that are so-called successful in single-parent households, they're actually very brittle, I've noticed. You can make it on you like that way, but they don't have the more rounded 360-degree discipline and everything, like that. Because the dad, can be tough. Men can have a certain energy and certain capacity to say, "Hey, no, you can't have that game. And don't bother nagging me either, because I'm not around for you to nag." I said, "No, now I'm going to work. That's my final say on that." The mom, it's all around, the kid's nagging, "Hey, mom, maybe I can do this, maybe I can do this." And it's not good. You need strong males in the world, and we don't have them anymore, really, not so many. That's what's under attack. The ETs have put males under attack. There's a war against men in this world. It's absurd. They say a war against women. It's exactly the opposite. It's a war against men is taking place here. And the extraterrestrials are the ones who are waging that war through their connections, through think tanks, through the United Nations, through governance, through the mandates, through these laws, through media, through all this stuff. It's all filtered down. Is we got to castrate the males, their authority, so they can't stand up to the ETs, essentially. And the women will be running things. The women say, "Yeah, we need the ETs. Come on in and help us out." And the men will say, "Wait a minute, wait, you didn't ask me. You didn't ask me about that. Oh, well, we thought, you'd like it. This Adam and Eve, you said, come on in, ETs, no problem." And then she says, "Oh, Adam, the ETs are here to help us out." Adam says, "Well, you didn't tell me." She goes, "Oh, yeah, I forgot." "Oh, well, you'll like it, don't worry." He said, "Well, actually, maybe I won't like it. And you didn't even ask me. It means you were worried that I might not like it." So it's a betrayal. So we've had a betrayal here on this planet. The women betrayed men because they thought, well, the ETs will do a better job. Now, the ETs are the ones that ruined the planet in the first place so that they would have an excuse to take it over. So I don't trust the ETs at all. They're not trustworthy. I trust the Dharma kings, the grace of God, the gurus, the saints, the saviors. I trust them. Because they're the ones who will lead us to the spirit of abidance. Okay? The ETs have no intention whatsoever of leading us to the spirit of abidance. None. Zero. Okay? That's not their goal at all. Their goal is to keep us as losers. Lovable losers. Sheep to be shorn. And that's what they're trying to do. So the Demon Masters are aware of this, and they will have their say. They'll have the final say on this. And I'm not going to live in a world that continues to demean men and carries out this war against men, right? Male authority is very important to balance out the world. It's very important. Natural authority abides with women in this world because they have the children. They raise the children. Children look to them for authority and what did they do. So you have to counterbalance that with male authority. Otherwise, the situation gets very unstable. Very unstable. And that's why religious organizations need to be male-oriented, male-dominated, just to balance it out. Otherwise, it gets completely out of balance. You can't have women running religion, too. No way. You can't have them running politics, either. That's how you keep things balanced between the male and the female. And you keep the nuclear families together, male and female. You raise children who are very disciplined, who have a 360-degree character to them. And this then produces a culture which goes towards spirit of abidance, okay? The value, ethics, and morals, and good habits, etc. And they're able to follow through on it. It produces way better culture. What we have right now is producing a terrible culture, actually. So brittle, so imbalanced. It's utterly ridiculous what's taking place in this world. And yeah, blame it on the ETs, which are just part of the dance of continuity fear, part of our own dance, a spiritual dance of continuity fear, of how do we keep losing? How do we keep avoiding what we really want? Well, the ETs are here, don't worry, they're here to help. You know, they'll really help us avoid what we really want. Yeah, sure they will. And in this world, we're so crazy, we define success as not getting what we really want. Yeah, I successfully avoided what I really want, and we call that success, and ETs say, wonderful, you know, great job. And, oh, the think tank geniuses say, great job too, yeah. And our leaders say, we're doing a great job. Wonderful, okay, we're great. We're successful. We successfully avoided what we really want. Is that a lunatic asylum or what? Of course it is. So, if we go in the direction of deciding to, you know, to push the war against men, which is what's really happening on this planet, to the ultimate extent, well, the Nemean masters will have their say, because men are very valuable. Very valuable. They're able to push back against that and push back against the world and liberate themselves from the belief in the necessity of the world. They're able to go find the success of abidance, the spirit of abidance. They're able to get that. They've historically shown they're able to do that. Women can do it also. But you need the men doing it. Okay, if the men aren't doing it, the women aren't going to do it. It's a pipe dream. They think, no, just put women in charge and we'll all go towards enlightenment. Everything will be great. That's an absolute ludicrous pipe dream. It doesn't work that way. No, they'll go to trying to make ourselves happy with failure. Glamorizing failure is what they do. Very, very clever at that. Women glamorize failure. They try to get me involved in helping them glamorize failure. It's terrible. They're very sneaky about that. We'll have a world that's super glamorized about failure, you know. And we'll be happy? No, we'll be miserable. So you need to champion men, to really champion men. We need a culture that champions men, because we keep defaulting back to championing mom. If we don't make a conscious effort to champion men, we default back into worshiping mom. But this is what happens. Worshiping failure. Because mom by herself is not going to get you there. Not at all. That's the world. The world's purpose is failure. So it takes tremendous determination and stick-to-itiveness to keep going towards success here. And some men can do this and some women can do this. But if you wipe out the men, good luck anybody doing it, actually. And I'm not going to stick around here to just be a token, you know, just used to glamorize failure. No, or just some token. That you have to have across-the-board championing of males on this planet. This is what's absolutely essential, because if you don't do that, we've already seen it, a total collapse into radical feminism across the planet, which is the spirit of failure, spirit of non-abidance. Feminism is actually the spirit of radical feminism is the spirit of non-abidance. A certain amount of feminism I support in the correct balance, you know. It's yeah, of course, but that's always been that way in the world, actually. It's really what we have now is the radical feminism of the extraterrestrials, which is a war against men. It's very much a war against men. And it's amazing how oblivious women, radical feminists, are to this. They say, no, it's a war against women. What are they talking? You know, they're projecting what they're doing. Like they're hoping, I hope nobody sees what we're doing, so let's just flip it and say, no, men are trying to wipe us out. No, we're trying to avoid our authority being exterminated, actually. Because it's terrible for women to have that happen, actually. So the championing men is standing up for women, actually. Because this greatly helps women in every which way. Deepen the mind, you know, and have this balance there and realize that it's not about the world. It's not about failure. It's about success. Genuine success of the spirit of abidance is what it's really about. It's not about the flesh. It's not about bodies. You know, none of that. all that is designed for failure. So we don't lionize women. We don't glamorize women. You can't have double standard for women on the path on this. And the Dharma doesn't have a double standard for women. No, they have, and they expect a double standard. I would treat me like a lady. Oh, you know, look the other way. I failed. Well, say I succeeded. You know, all these perks they want. There are no perks in the Dharma like that. There's a lot of women don't like that. They want all these perks. There aren't any such perks. A success is success, and failure is failure. It's pass fail. A succeed or fail. And you're not doing anyone any help at all by treating their, you know, women at double standard, like a lady. Oh, well, yeah, how does that, it doesn't help at all. It hurts. Because they think, well, it's okay, I can fail here, I can fail here, I can fail here, I don't need to do this, I don't need to do that. You become lazy and that's a path to failure. So the men, maybe, you know, you're treated very sternly. And women say, no, that's not fair, you're hurting me, you know, I'm too brittle, you can't treat me that way. What are you talking about? So feminism has become like the reverse, that they're all so brittle now. Women are so brittle, they're so unbelievably brittle. I thought feminism was about women not being brittle anymore. It turned out they're more brittle than ever. And back in the day, the non-feminists, they're the ones who actually are flexible enough to be admonished and say, hey, you know, this is failure. You need to wow your success. You need to repent. You know, you can't have a double standard. Well, men need to repent, but women don't need to. This is absurd. You will continue with failure until you repent. So what, women, they deserve to fail? That's what the world's saying. I'm saying, no, they deserve to succeed. But the direction the ETs are taking us in is failure. Spiritual failure, you know. The spirit of non-abidance. So, this is playing out in the world right now. With the U.S. election, obviously, I mean, Hillary Clinton's a radical feminist, and she's never shown any capacity to stand up to radical feminism whatsoever. They govern her. She's a front for them, which is a war against men. So she's a front for the war against men. And, you know, so if she happens to win, the Enigma Masters are going to do something for sure. I would say, for sure. And they're not going to let their proteges and those who've repented, they're not going to let them just be wiped out by this war against men. They won't let that happen. They shouldn't let it happen. No business person is going to allow their business to be devastated like that. They're in the business of success. And you don't have success in a culture unless you have strong male authority in that culture. Why has Tibetan Buddhism been so successful? Maybe the most successful tradition in history. Strong male authority. Okay? Strong male authority. And the women who respect that. That's why they've been so successful. And that is what the war is against. It's trying to wipe out male authority, and this is going to cause women to flounder in failure. Flounder in failure. Look at Chandra Sering Chodron, the great Dakini, Tibetan Dakini. What did she do? She respected the authority of Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodo and the male authority of Tibetan Buddhism, and therefore she was able to absorb the Dharma in that way. Okay? And was extremely successful at it. And she said that feminism is completely off track and out of whack. This is that is ruinous. It's ruinous. And that was a woman saying that. Because she understood. She understood how it works. The ETs, again, which is they're the ones really who have engineered this society, modern society, they're idiots. Okay? Maybe idiot savants, but idiots nonetheless. They're experts at sabotage and failure. That's what they're experts at. And so, you know, we're not playing their game. The Enigma Masters aren't going to play their game, so they're going to maybe get their feelings hurt. I don't know. They think that, you know, we have to play things their way. No, we don't. And we won't. We don't, and we won't. So I don't know what they're going to do. They haven't told me. They don't want to burden me with that. So whatever it is they do, it will be wonderful. Very wowish and wonderful. And there's a lot of wise women in the world. There's a lot of lying women in the world, a lot of wise women in the world. Not every woman is a feminist. And a lot of them realize, hey, strong male authority is very helpful. Very, very helpful. And we need to be admonished. I mean, who doesn't want to be admonished? You got to be crazy not to be admonished. Who doesn't want to repent? Right? I mean, how could you not want to repent? How could you not want to want success? But again, most of this world, their only goal is to avoid success, to fail. And so they're structuring society in such a way as to guarantee their failure. The modern society, the trends that are coming in the future, is to guarantee our failure. So I don't have any role in that at all. I'm not here to guarantee anyone's failure. I'm here to guarantee everyone's success. And everyone will succeed. I mean, those who want to fail will succeed at failure, and those who want to succeed will succeed at success. And those who are succeeding at failure will ultimately realize that they're so miserable that they decide to succeed at success, and then they'll succeed at that too. So we're all brilliantly successful. I have absolute confidence in everyone's rapid success in the Dharma once you repent and recognize, wow, it's really continuity fear that's the problem, huh? Wow. That's all that it is. I got a really severe problem here. I'm sabotaging myself. Yeah. And why continuity fear? What's continuity fear about? It's success. I'm afraid of abidance. Why? Because I'm so used to identifying myself with partiality. And not being what I am. I don't know what that would be like. Oh, I'm so scared. You know, continuity fear has got a very big fear of familiarity. But it can be evaporated. And that's what the gurus help us evaporate the continuity fear. They're experts at it. So what does Trump represent? Male authority, okay? And that's what the ETs hate. They hate it. I don't fear it. He's imbalanced because the women have too much control over him. But they can't completely control him, which they're frightened of. They try to demonize him over that. But male authority is not always going to do what the women want it to do, nor should it. And vice versa. And it's a balance. It's a balance. We need male authority in the world now. Strong male authority. But, you know, we'll see what happens. I don't know what's going to happen. It's doubtful. We'll get that. The United Nations, the ETs, the think tanks, everyone is aligned against it. It's from that side. You know, that side of the progressive, they're all aligned against it. Like it's the holy grail for them is to destroy male authority on this planet. That's their holy grail. And since I have a lot of male authority, you know, I certainly am aware of their plans to destroy male authority. Meaning I can speak my own mind based on the spirit of abidance and not trying to please mother, okay? Not trying to please the world. I'm not here to please the world. The world is trying to sabotage our success. So why should I try to please the world? I'm not here to hurt the world or to demean it or denounce it or anything, you know, denigrate the world. It's very beautiful in subtle ways. But you know, it's very superficial, the world, actually. And it's just our own mental projection. So I'm here to save everyone from the world. Actually, not to save the world, but to save us from the world, and the world save the world from us too. I mean, not that there's any existence on its own, but we're here to save everyone from the world. And that's, you know, the world is going towards failure to do that. It's worshiping failure, which is what it keeps lapsing back into. Jesus brought success to this world, saying, look, he was, you know, Mr. Success. and say, this is what you can do. You see, he had utter dominion over the world, didn't he? He said to the storm, stop. The storm stopped right away. They said, what is this man that every nature obeys him? Even death, he said, death, depart from me. He's back alive again. That's right. Death is just to depart from me. Death is the world, right? All that's the world. The world has no dominion over us whatsoever. And the spirit of non-abiding says it does. And that's the spirit of mother telling you, yeah, the world has authority over you, and you have to follow the world's authority. And the man will say, wait a minute. Not necessarily. You know, the world doesn't necessarily have that much authority over you. You can do some things, you know. And so, you know, there has to be a strong male presence and voice in this world. Otherwise, we will just flounder, continue to flounder, as we're floundering. The culture is floundering so bad now because of so many single-parent households. The ET's purpose was to break up the nuclear family, get the woman to work so she's not in the house, get the woman to be so materialistic the man has to work nonstop to pay all the bills. She has to buy this, buy this, buy this, upgrade, 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 upgrade. So he's always working all the time. He's not around. She's not around because she's also working to pay, buy all these things. The kids at home, what, being babysat by the television, which is controlled by the extraterrestrial think tank, United Nations, entertainment, media, which is conditioning the children for the culture they want. So they want as many divorces as possible. ETs, they want every household to be a single parent household, which just destroys the children's faith and confidence and toughness and discipline. And this is what they've done. I know a lot of people blame the communists and socialists for that. Well, they run out of control of the ETs too, but it's the ETs that are to blame for this, actually. And this is how they've subverted this world. And then the kids, they get on drugs. There's not enough parental supervision. The parents are too busy. Before, the mom was at home. She was watching everyone like a hawk and making sure they don't get into bad habits. She knows what they're doing. The man comes home from work. He gets time off, you know, to be with the family, a lot of time off. And she tells him, this is what the kids are doing. I need some help here with the authority. The man says, okay, we're going to do this, kids. We're going to do this. We're going to do this. And the kids get used to that strong male presence doing stuff with the father. And they toughen up. Nowadays, the father's never around, the mother's not around, the kids are raised by corporations, actually. Corporations are raising the kids. We have like a fourth generation of corporate kids now. That's what we got. We have corporate kids. They're messed up. That's not going to make the grade. You know, that's not what the Enigma Masters are looking for. You don't, that does, they don't have the toughness, the discipline. I mean, my dad was tough. Very tough. Very inspiring also. Very brilliant. Very inspiring. Renaissance man. 360-degree man. In every direction. You know, we come across some of his artwork and things and doodles and stuff he did. Everything he did was artistic. His writing, His cards, he'd make his own cards for every occasion with all his own artwork. He didn't go down and buy a Hallmark card. He made his own cards. And he had us make cards. He taught us, you know, beautiful cards, gorgeous artwork. I look and I say, oh my gosh, this is a genius. He was an artistic genius, actually. But that was just one thing he did. He did so many things. World traveler, educator, you know, on and on and on and on. Spiritual aspirant, high culture. Everything was high culture. And he demanded that we focus our attention on this stuff and demanded its importance. He refused to allow us television in the house. If it wasn't for him, we would have had television and it'd been on 24 hours a day. Okay, but he said no television in this house. He refused newspapers. He said you only get the news from reliable sources as much as possible. He says the corporations are trying to indoctrinate you. I won't allow that in my household. And he was the one that put his foot down, not the mother. It was the father who put the foot down. And the mother had to go along with it. Now, she didn't really like it that much. But she had to go along with it. And she said, well, you know, that's sexist. No. That actually was a great thing that he did. Okay? Because he wasn't trapped by materialism. He had a higher goal, which was liberation. So, you know, I looking back, I respected my dad so much. He was very tough and didn't like having his authority challenged. I challenged his authority by saying, look, you know, your picture is great, but it has to be better, and I'll help it be better. He didn't like that. Not at all. But he was an extraordinary man. And there are many, many men like that in that generation. They were extraordinary, extraordinary. And I was super great blessed to have a father like that and a generation of men like that as my uncles and my father's friends and people like that, where I got to see just how competent they really were, how extraordinary they really were. And so there's all this feminist lies about men, you know, I was able to say, you know, something isn't right here. You know, something is really phony. That's not real women that are talking. There's some. What is talking through them? Well, corporations are talking through them. Materialism is talking through them. United Nations, think tanks, and ultimately extraterrestrials are talking through them. And they're just like puppets of these, you know, just trying to, you know, destroy male authority on the planet. And of course, they'll say, oh, you're ridiculous. Blah. No, I'm not ridiculous. I had great male mentors. And they wouldn't put up with this nonsense at all. They'd see right through it. Easy to see through it. And the women didn't even try it back then because it was easy to see through it. They had more dignity than to try to play a fool like that, you know, to play some male for a fool like that. They wouldn't get away with that. Religion wouldn't let them get away with that stuff, what they get away with now. The constant lies they spout, they couldn't get away with that stuff, and they shouldn't. So, this is where we're at. And it's a great time because the Nyingma Masters guarantee me, you've said your prayers, and we are going to answer your prayers, okay? We are going to answer your prayers. They're in the business of answering prayers. They're in the business of promoting our faith in success, okay? In that we have dominion over our experiencing. They're in that business of enabling our faith, enabling the spirit of abidance. They're in that business to enable the spirit of abidance, and they will continue to be in that business. Okay, they will continue to be in that business, and they will continue to be successful in that. Okay, so with that, we will say adieu to the next taping. Very great. That's it.